I want to pray and hand over because our time has really gone. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I come before your throne. I want to thank you for the service today. I want to thank you for everybody that is joining us, Lord. And I want to thank you for the gift of our reverend today. Even as he speaks your word, dear Lord, that we shall be rooted in you, dear Lord, that we shall be taught by you. I pray for eloquence. I pray for grace and utterances, Lord, that are enabled by the Spirit. I take charge of the spiritual realm, and I decree no distortion in Jesus' name. I decree no distortion in Jesus' name. I decree the airwaves are clear in the name of Jesus Christ. We shall hear the word and be transformed in the power of the gospel. Thank you for everybody that is tuning in. Thank you, even as you give them the grace, as you give them the understanding, Lord, that no evil veil will cover their faces, their minds, Lord, to cause them not to understand your word. Proceed forth in grace and in power. In Jesus' name, I pray. So let's proceed, and God will bless you.
Amen. I want to thank God for giving us an opportunity this lunch hour so that we can be able to hear the word of God. The Bible says the faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. I think that this lunch hour is going to be a blessing to us, and God is going to teach us great and mighty things that are going to impact our lives so that we will continue serving the Lord in our generation. I want to tackle the subject of understanding salvation. Understand salvation, because I know that there is a lot of confusion here in the world. People are confused. They don't actually understand what the salvation is all about. Many say that when they are baptized, they got saved, and they are people use a lot of ways to describe salvation. Some people say that you have to go some under certain rituals, and then you're saved. But we want to critically look into the word of God, salvation is all about, and how does one receive salvation? And after you have been born again, after you've been saved, what kind of life do you live, and how do you conduct yourself as a person? What is your walk with God and such as things? I know they're going to really help us to understand salvation so that we can to stand our ground, because I know there is a lot of temptation out there in the world. And so I want to begin by asking ourselves, what is salvation? What is salvation? And in a simple description, salvation is the redemption by God. It is the redemption by God from the effects of sin. It is the redemption of God from the effects of sin. I want to take you back to the book of Genesis, and in the Garden of Eden, where we see the first man was created by God in his image and after his likeness. And then God put him in the Garden of Eden. Actually, the word it means God's delight, or he was put in the presence of God. And now he was given instructions, or instruction that he was given, that he should not eat the tree that was a bit of the garden. And immediately was told, now we see, because man did contrary to the word of God, what happened when he did contrary to the word of God, there was a disconnect. There was a disconnect. And we are going to see what man lost in the Garden of Eden. And actually, what man lost in the Garden of Eden, we call the life of God. As far as he was in the fellowship of God, the life of God was with him. There are two dimensions of life. And one dimension is called grants. But there is the life of God that is called the Zoe life. The Zoe life. The Zoe life is what maintained the man in the Garden of Eden. And so she could be able to relate with God. So immediately he did contrary to the word of God. What happened? The man lost the Zoe life. So he lost the Zoe life because the effects of sin in any man, what they do, they interfere with the life of God in that man. Because when you have a relationship with God or a relationship with Jesus Christ, what happens is that you receive the life of God. And that life of God, what I'm calling the Zoe life, that dimension of life, the Zoe life, is the life that helps you to have a continued fellowship with God. And as you continue having a fellowship with God, of course, the presence of God fills you, and the glory of God is upon you. If you read in the book of Romans chapter 6, maybe we can read there, Romans chapter number 6. Let us hear what the word of God says, so that we can be able to walk this journey of understanding salvation together, so that you can be able to get it very clearly. And I know it is going to be a blessing to us. Bible says in Romans chapter 6 and verse number 23, Bible says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The effects of sin, the Bible says, the wages of sin, the effects of sin is death. So when man sinned against God in the Garden of Eden, what man attracted through sin into his life, it is death. It's the absence of the Zoe life. It's actually death. It's what we call spiritual death, because there is no connection. You are not connected with God. I'm going to explain about that later. Now, so when we speak about salvation, there are two words that speak about salvation in the Greek language, because you know the New Testament originally it was written in Greek. There are two words for salvation. There is soteria and there is sozo. But now when you're speaking about the redemption of God from the effects of sin to man, we are speaking about this sozo. We are speaking about sozo, salvation, sozo, because it goes beyond. It also includes you as being healed, even physically, being delivered from the enemy. So it is very comprehensive. It's very wide. That's why I say it is the redemption by God from the effects of sin. And the word of redemption is very key. You're going to understand salvation, because redemption, it actually means buying back. It is as if God bought us back, paid the price of bringing back us back to himself as his people. So it actually, we have to understand that everyone who sins must pay the ultimate penalty, that is death, and that is both physical and spiritual. And we have to understand there are three types of death, and we have to understand them. And one of them is called internal death. That is when one is separated from God internally. And there is also spiritual death. Spiritual death is when you are separated from God. You don't have a relationship with him. It is the absence of the Zoe life. The absence of the Zoe life brings a spiritual death. But one continues to live in the spiritual life. I want you to understand. One continues to live in the spiritual life, but he does not have the Zoe life of God. And so there is also the physical death. That one I don't have to explain. You know about it. But what I want to explain is about the spiritual death, the spiritual death, because I say it is the absence of the Zoe of God. You know, the Zoe of God, it is what, it's the power of God that works in us and actually maintains, helps us to maintain a relationship and a connection with God. And it is so powerful because it also causes growth. It causes us to grow in Christ. It also helps us even to know Him better. Let us ask ourselves this question as we continue. How does one receive salvation? Because the very key, it is very important. How does one receive salvation? And I want to say that everyone that is born of a woman, it is born in the Adamic nature. The Adamic nature is the nature of sin. Is the nature of sin. The Bible clearly records in the book of Romans that the first Adam brought death. But now the second Adam, who is Jesus Christ, has brought life. Now, I'm still taking you back to the Zoe life because it is very important to understand. Then, how do we receive salvation? How do you receive salvation? The Bible records in the book of Romans chapter 10. Let us go there. Bible records in the book of Romans chapter number 10, in verse number 8. The word of God says, but what says it? Eh? What says it? The word is high and deep, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which is preached. Verse 9, it says, that if thou confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and thou shalt believe in thy heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. You shall be saved. I said that the wages of sin is death. But so as to receive salvation, and salvation is what brings the Zoe life now back to us. Now, the Bible says you have to hear message or the preaching of the gospel of the kingdom of God, not any other gospel, the gospel of the kingdom. And Jesus said, he said that the gospel of the kingdom shall be preached unto all creatures, whatever is included in the word creature. The Bible says that the gospel shall be preached to them. So before, for you to receive salvation, you have to hear the preaching of the gospel. And the preaching of the gospel, it is Christ-centered. It is Christocentric. It is Christ-centered. It is not about a person. No, it is about Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world. The Bible records in the book of John 5 and 26, as God has life, it is God the Father who has the life to give that same life to the Son, that whoever shall believe in the Son, now who is Jesus Christ, he shall do what? He shall be saved. He shall see the same life. Remember where we came from, I said that salvation is the redemption by God from the effects of sin. What was destroyed by sin, now by receiving Jesus Christ, there is a restoration, there is a level of restoration that we receive. Now, for us to understand salvation, it is very important for us to understand what we call the tripartite of a man. The tripartite of a man. And when I speak about the tripartite of a man, I'm speaking about the spirit. Man has a spirit, he has a soul, and he has a body. He has a spirit, and he has soul, and he has the body. Now, if you draw a circle, I want you to imagine and draw a circle. Draw three circles. And at the center of that circle, of the first circle, I want you to write the word spirit. And on the second circle, I want you to write the word soul. And on the third one, which is the outer one, I want you to write the word body. So now, work now for you to receive salvation, it is very important we understand this part, because you have to ask yourself, which part of you then receives the salvation? Remember, our job saying that when a man sinned, the absence of the Zoe life of God, it separates man from God. Now, what received now salvation, it is your spirit man. Your spirit man, when you accept Jesus Christ. Now, let me go back. And when you hear the preaching of the gospel, you believe in that gospel, then the Bible says that you receive that gospel in your heart. You believe it in your heart that you are a sinner. You cannot save yourself, and you need a savior who is Jesus Christ. And you believe that gospel, then the Bible says you confess in your mouth. You confess with your mouth. And when you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, it is something that happens within a twinkling of an eye. Salvation happens within a twinkling of an eye. And what happens now, it is that your spirit man, remember, let me take you back to the three circles. The center now, you're speaking about the spirit. The spirit, your spirit is regenerated. It is regenerated. Regeneration, it is given life now, right back. Life now, with life. You know, of course now, before you are born again, you have the such a life, and you do things normally. You walk like any other people, but there is the minus, there is the absence of the Zoe life, so you are not connected with God. So when you confess Jesus Christ, what happens is that now the Zoe life, you receive the Zoe life in your spirit, and your spirit is regenerated. So you're born again. And the Bible says that then, in John 1 and 12, the Bible says that then that received him, who Jesus Christ, they have received, they have believed the preaching of the gospel, and they have confessed Christ. The Bible says, then we are given the power to become the children of God, children who are not born of the will of the flesh, but are born by the Spirit. They are born by the Spirit. It's now this what I'm calling regeneration. Your spirit is regenerated, is connected back to God. And now there is a fellowship. A fellowship between you and God begins. And when it begins, it has to start from there. So now let me come back to the soul. In the soul, there are three parts in the soul. And in the soul, there is what we call the mind. And there is the will. And there is the emotions. Now, at salvation, your spirit is regenerated. But your soul has to undergo a transformation. And this is on a daily basis. It has to undergo a transformation, but it is on a daily basis. And we check in the book of Romans, chapter number 12, so that we understand what I'm saying. Chapter number 12 of the book of Romans. Let me read. The Bible says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. When Paul is speaking this word to the churches, he is speaking to us today. Now, he actually has a picture of what was happening in the Old Covenant, in the book of Leviticus, because a sinner, you know, used to bring a lamb without the blemish. They are the conditions that we are given. And the priest could lay their hands on that lamb, and meaning that the sin of the person who brought that lamb is being transformed, is being transferred now to that lamb that he has brought. And there was the process that the priest was going, was doing the ministration as it was ordained. But now, when we come to the dispensation of grace, because right now, when Christ came, the Bible says that Christ came with the truth, with the grace and truth. We are in the dispensation of grace, the dispensation of grace whereby we are access salvation not by works, and don't be deceived by anybody. It is not by works, it is not by your good work, it is by the grace of God. We are saved by the grace of God, and because we are in the dispensation of grace, so now the window of the old covenant was closed, and now we are in another covenant, and in this covenant now it speaks about you now. It is speaking about you now, because now you become the temple of the living God. You become the temple of the living God. So the sacrifices that were done in the old covenant, I want you to understand, they were just by the shadow. But now when Christ came, Christ is the reality. Christ is the reality. And now Paul is saying, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present now your body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. So what does it mean like this? What does it mean? Let me read verse number 2 so that I can be able to connect verse 2 and verse number 1 as we flow together. Now, the Bible says in verse 2, but don't be conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Now, I've gone back to your soul. Your soul, I've said that your soul has three parts. That is the mind, the will, and the emotions. Now, he is saying that, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. So, your mind has to go a transformation every day. And he goes a transformation every day by the means of the word of God. And that's why we read in the book of Joshua that Joshua was told by God, but this book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but you shall meditate it day and night, and you shall be careful to do what is written there on. It is a daily transformation, a daily renewal by the word of God. And now, because you have received Jesus Christ, the Bible says now your old has gone and a new has come. You know, now you are a new creature. The new creature that you are does not feed on a physical food, but it feeds on the word of God. And so when you begin that journey in salvation and begin to walk and begin to feed on the word of God, and actually James says, be hearers and doers of the word. When we do that and allow that word to work in our mind, if there is a transformation, there is a renewal, and you're able to know and actually prove what is the perfect and the good will of God as far as our lives is concerned. And so you begin a journey of transformation, a journey of transformation. So the things that you used to do, there are things that you used to do, and maybe according to you and according to what you were doing that time that you have not received Christ, those things were good. But now, when you have come to Christ, there has to be a total change. There has to be a total transformation, because you have received the life of God. And this life of God, it has its dimensions of operations. It has a dimension of operation. It has an environment of operation. And in this environment of operation, what you need to understand, you have to be holy. You have to be holy. You know, your mind has to be cleansed every day. The evil thought, the patterns that used to control you, now you cannot be controlled by those patterns. You can only be controlled by the word of God. And that's why the Bible says that, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Do not be conformed to this world. There is the operations of this world. There are things that this world upholds, but they are not good to you as a child of the kingdom of God. A good example, if you were a drunkard, you cannot continue drinking. If you are a smoker, you cannot continue smoking. You cannot just continue doing things the way we are doing. There has to be a kind of transformation, and it is a gradual transformation. I thank God one day I read a book that is called The Beauty of Transformation. And the writer of the book is giving us an analogy of how before a butterfly is transformed from the egg, the pupa, the larva, and then there is the adult. I think those are the four stages. There is the egg, there is the pupa, the larva, and then there is the adult. You know, the adult, you can be able to see the beauty of the adult and it and the arrogance and the arrogance at which that is right, and it exposes that beauty. It is the same way a believer has to undergo a transformation when you begin the journey of salvation. When you receive the Zoe life, it has the capacity, it has the potential to transform your life into what God desired you to be. And what was damaged by sin, God restores back. But remember, this calls for your personal discipline. There has to be your personal discipline. And let me say, it does not mean that when you are born again, they are not going to be challenges challenges there. In fact, there are so many challenges, but there is the way this life of God is going to help you and even to get it through. So when you receive Jesus Christ, you have to do what? You have to be ready to die. You know, the self to die, the body. Remember, let me take you back to the circle. The body, because it will depend on which way you are going to bend. If you bend on the way of the flesh, you're going to walk the way of the flesh. And if you bend on the way of the spirit, the Bible says that walk in the spirit, and you shall not gratify the things of the flesh. Remember, the spirit gives life. The spirit gives life. The Zoe of God, and it gives life. So when you bend in the realm of the spirit and begin to walk in the spirit, you're going to manifest the Zoe of God. And how do you manifest the Zoe of God? There is a transformation. Even the people who knew you there before, they're going to see maybe you are an alcoholic or something. But now when they see that transformation happening in your life, you're going to witness of the sin, because it is real life, and it has the power to change and to transform. So after salvation, there is that work, there is that transformation. So we need to understand that some people do not understand. And it was also very hard for somebody called Nicodemus in the book of John 3, from verse 3 to 6. No, Nicodemus is asking Jesus Christ, how do I go back to my mother's womb and I'm born again when I'm old? Because he was actually trying to interpret spiritual things physically. So it does not apply. And there is a word that Jesus told him, and he told him that whoever is born of the water and of the spirit shall enter into the kingdom of God. That is what I'm calling the generation. It is being born through the word of God and through the spirit of God. So now you become a child of God. And when you become a child of God, you begin to walk in the same. And so what we need to understand, brethren, as far as salvation is concerned, is that now Jesus was speaking to the Jews who had believed in him. And he told, this is in the book of John chapter 8 and verse 31 and 32. And he was telling them that indeed, if you walk in my, if you walk in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. In salvation, you receive salvation, and you begin that walk, that transformation, that gradual process of transformation. How does it happen in your life? Because it is very key for you to understand. One of the things that will help you, it is having a revelation, a clear revelation of who Jesus is in your life and what has happened in your life. That regeneration, when you have revelation of what has happened, that regeneration that has happened in your life, there is a knowing. And in that knowing, there is a transformation. When you know about something, it actually means an absence of darkness. And when there is an absence of darkness, there is light. So your heart is illuminated. There is a light that is shed in your heart, and that light helps you to understand what is the will of God. And there is a knowing that happens in your spirit man. And this knowing will help you to stand in the ground. It will stand, it will help you to overcome any circumstances of life, any opposition that it may be encountered. And even if people try to contradict what you have believed in, you cannot give in, because there is a shedding of light in your heart through that revelation of the power of regeneration that has happened in your life. And if you can read in the book of Ephesians chapter 1, maybe we can go to the book of Ephesians, because this is very important. The book of Ephesians chapter 1 and verse number 17. Verse 17. The Bible says that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him who, Christ who has given you the life. As God has life, he gave life to the Son. As whoever has believed in him should have the same life. So when you have a revelation of that life, I tell you, you will walk in the power of transformation every day, every day. And you begin to grow and actually attain, grow in the nature of Christ. And actually, you'll be able to manifest the power and the will of God in your life. Another thing that will help bring a knowing, that will bring a transformation in your life, it is through meditation. And when we speak about meditation, we are not speaking about the meditation that is done by the people who practice yoga. You know, they do some the kind of meditation they do, it is they empty your mind and they infuse other things. But now we are speaking about meditating upon the word of God. When you are born again, you begin meditating upon the word of God. You meditate upon the word of God. And when you meditate upon the word of God, there is a knowing that is released in your spirit. And that knowing actually brings a level of stability in your Christian walk. And let me tell you, in that stability, you will overcome the temptations of compromise, the temptation of lowering the standards of God in your life. And actually, you pray.
Praise the Lord. We are talking about meditating on the word of God, a meditation that will bring us to the knowledge of God and to a deeper understanding of God. Yeah, maybe I can continue before we have him back. so that we do not waste time. And I can see, oh, I'm talking about wasting. Yes, as we wait for him. So we are talking about salvation and the transformation that we receive when we receive Jesus Christ. And I love the way he has brought it out, that it's the spirit that gets born again. It is your spirit man that receives Jesus Christ. And then from there, your soul, which carries your mind, which carries your will, which carries your emotion, should now follow. And that is why now we have the meetings we do, the fellowships we do, that help us to be able to bring along this other part of the body. Now, as you're saying, meditating on the word of God, because we receive salvation when we heard the word of God. And actually that Romans he was reading says, then how can we be saved if nobody preaches to us? And how can somebody preach to us who has not been sent? Somebody must be sent with the gospel of peace. And then we hear that gospel, we believe in it, then we are saved. And then the Bible says we must believe that Jesus Christ, he died and rose again. And why did he die? For us. Why? And resurrected. So he did not only die, but came to resurrection. And then we confess him as Lord. So as you believe, there are others who say, I have believed, I don't need to confess. So there is a confession that brings the salvation. And then from there, that is where the Bible says that we work out our salvation with trembling and fear. Let's see whether our Reverend is able to continue. Reverend?
I was sorry for the technical hitch. I was speaking about a knowing that comes through participation. John 8, 31 and 32. When you know the truth and that truth, the truth that you have participated in, participation is acting upon that truth. And then there is a transformation that comes. Now, what you know, what you need to understand, after you have received the Christ, you cannot live the same way again. You cannot live the way you want. You cannot live carelessly. No, there are even places you're not supposed to go, because places that do not glorify God, and even talking and even watching videos and all those, because the Bible says in the book of Jeremiah 10 and 23 that a man's life is not his own. It is not for a man to direct his ways. Now, when you receive Jesus Christ, Christ becomes the center focus of your life. The one that leads you, the one that leads you, the way you are going to do things. Bible says, in all your ways, you shall acknowledge God, and he shall direct your path. So, you read in the book of in the book of Psalm 1. Let us go to Psalm 1. Someone, there is something that is very important there. Verse 1 of someone, the Bible says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. Bible says we love all people, but when it comes to levels of fellowship, the levels of mingling together, you have to be very careful, because the Bible says that there's no fellowship between light and darkness. So you cannot just continue living the way you want and carelessly. You know, now you begin to have a level of discipline in the way you walk. The Bible says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. Every man, and or every human being, there are three things that happens in their lives. It is either you are walking, you are standing, or you are sitting. Three things. So, but now the determining factor is, who are you walking with? Who do you worship? The one kids is that they have to do with the fellowship. That is why the Bible says that the Enoch with the fellowship with the God. So the Bible says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel. You don't have a fellowship of the counsel. Who counsels your life? Now, when you have received the Christ, the Holy Spirit and the Word of God becomes your counsel. It becomes your fellowship. And the Bible says, must stand in the way of sinners. You can't do the way the sinners, the heathen, the them that are not with Christ. You know, you have to understand it, that the people you fellowship together with, they either influence your life positively or negatively, depending on what you are doing at a particular time. And that's why your life has to change. There has to go that kind of, let me call it the metamorphosis. It has to be transformed. And the Bible says, no, seated in the seat of the scornful. That is why I said that you cannot live carelessly, because now your life is not your own. Christ holds your life. The soil of God is in your life. Let me say, it has the conditions, it has its own ways of doing things as a believer. So, and the Bible says that now, the all things that you should begin to do, you shall do them for the glory of God. You shall do them for the glory of God. And so, my brother and my sister, wherever you are, I want to tell you that after you have received Jesus Christ, the work of salvation is the work of the fear of God. It is the work of the counsel of God. You begin to seek God. You begin to be connected with Him. And there are things that you need to detach yourself. And that's why I'm very keen on this. You cannot live carelessly. You cannot afford to live carelessly, because now you are a child of the living God, and God takes care of you. Now, the Bible says in the book of Philippians, chapter 2 and verse number 12, the book of Philippians chapter number 2 and verse number 12, the Word of God says, that, therefore, my brethren, as you have always obeyed, not in my presence only, but not much in my absence, work out your salvation. That source of salvation, that redemptive work that has begun in your life, the Bible says it is your responsibility. You are saved today, you do not pay anything. But after salvation, the working out of your salvation. And the working out, I tend to think it is your becoming. You know, let me paraphrase it. Now, because you have received Christ, now work out your becoming. You are becoming that what God intended you to become. That original plan that God had for you ever before He laid down the foundations of the earth. Let me read the book of Ephesians chapter 2 in verse number 10, so that we can have a basic of understanding of what I'm speaking about. Verse 10 of Ephesians, the Bible says, for we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, unto good works which God has before ordained that we should walk in them. Let me read the Amplified Version. The Amplified Version says, for we are God's own handiwork, His workmanship, recreated in Christ Jesus, born anew, that we may do those good works which God predestined, planned for us, taking part of which He prepared ahead of time that we should walk in them, living the good life which He pre-arranged and made ready for last week. So that path of righteousness that you have received do not pray, because He has restored you back to the soil life. Now you walk in that path of righteousness, of holiness. You know, fearing God, worshiping God, seeking God. What, you become a worshiper of God. You worship Him in the spirit and in the truth.
the kind of life you live, you know, it reflects Christ. You know, Christ is glorified. The way you talk, the way you handle issues, the kind of status you put in your thoughts, it reflects Christ. The kind of clothing that you put on, my goodness, you know, it reflects Christ. And Christ is always honored. The way you talk, the people you relate to, in your working place, actually, you become an ambassador of Jesus Christ. The Bible says there was good work the Lord did for us, because now we have come to Christ. The Bible says, let me read again, for we have God's own handle, which is recreated in Christ Jesus our Lord, born anew, that we may do the work of righteousness. That work in the manifest Christ. And that's why we have read in Philippians 2:12 that now work out, because you have received Christ. Now work out, begin to work out. You know yourself, really, you did not pay anything, there is not anything. But now that the work of salvation is becoming what God desired you to become, Galatians 2:10, it is has a responsibility on yourself. It is your own responsibility. You begin to work out that journey. You begin to work out. You begin to walk that walk. You let the transformation that by the word of God and listening to the Holy Spirit. And being connected to the Holy Spirit, because there's also more of being filled by the Holy Spirit and being baptized in the Holy Spirit, so that you can be able to work out and become that what God desires to become. And I believe at this level, the greatest prayer you can ever pray for your life, my brother and my sister, it is the prayer of becoming what God desires you to become. That is the greatest prayer. You know, people pray a lot of things. They pray for me. And I'm not saying it is bad in itself, but what I actually want to say, I want to say that the greatest prayer you can ever pray for yourself, it is a prayer of becoming what God desires you to become. You begin the work of salvation, the journey of salvation, to be transformed, being renewed in your mind, because your spirit has already been regenerated, and walking that walk day by day, and you shall live to manifest Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Let me say that we have been called for eternity. Salvation, you are called for eternity. It says in the book of Ecclesiastes that God has hidden eternity in a man, and yet they don't know. So this is very key for us be able to understand, so that in our walk of salvation, we are, you know, there are always checks and balances. You know, you have to be very careful, because it is all about life, and it is all about the life of God. There are things that are manifested by the life of God, and it cannot not be manifested by anything else. Like it or you don't like it, it cannot be not be manifested by anything else. And that is why we need to be very careful as far as salvation is concerned, the glory of God. Let me pray that God will help us, and we are going to walk that journey, and God will be glorified in our lives to the glory of His name. Everlasting Father, I want to thank you this afternoon that you have given us an opportunity to hear your word. The Bible says that the entrance of your word bringeth right and understanding to the simple. God, I believe by the power of this word, there is illumination that you are releasing upon my listeners in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Wherever they are listening from, our God, wherever they are falling in the social media, in the Facebook, in YouTube, oh God, my Father in terror, I declare in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, the power of the resurrected Christ, joy of God will continue working in our hearts, receive the power and the grace to be able to walk in salvation in the name of God, in the wisdom of God, in the counsel of God, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Father God, because you have called us into your own God mighty. I want to pray that God, there is nothing that is going to come between us and you. We are not going to compromise your standard. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we say no to any worldly patterns. We are not going to be confirmed to them. But God Almighty, every day of our lives, by the power of your word, our mind shall be renewed by your word, oh God. We are going to prove that which is perfect, that which is good will, as concerns us, that you ordained for us, that we should walk therein day by day, that Christ will be glorified, that Christ will become the center focus in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I bind and I refuse any law of the creeping things from the pit of hell. I declare, Father, any spirit that comes, that creeps in your life, my God, to release a lower that will become of a lower type. I refuse the spirit of degeneration in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. And God, we declare we're going to walk in the fullness of your power by salvation and by the Holy Ghost in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, I thank you. I give you the praise and the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. God bless you.
Amen, amen. Thank you. We are edified. That is good food. God bless you. So I am sure you have heard the word of God, and I do not want to add much. I want us to call it a day. Our reverend has prayed for us, and we believe in the word of God. I only want to read one more scripture here. The Bible says in Matthew 3 and verses 7, but when John saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming to his place of baptism, he said to them, you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit then in keeping with repentance, and do not presume to say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our father. For I tell you that out of these stones, God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe lies ready at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. So these are the Pharisees that had come to receive repentance before Christ had started preaching or had started ministry. And John was warning them, and he told them, do not say that you are the children of Abraham or you're the seed of Abraham. He told him, I tell you that God is able to raise children for Abraham from these stones. So when we get to salvation, we are, actually the Bible says, we are grafted into the tree, in the family of Abraham, and we become the children of God. That is why John was warning that we produce fruit that befit repentance. And Paul was saying in, is it Romans, Galatians 6, and he was saying that if you have been saved by grace, do we continue sinning so that grace can abide? And he says, certainly not. So when we have come to Christ, we are, you know, somebody always told us that the only thing we receive in the silver platter is salvation. And I don't know whether that's why we take it for granted, but we need to put effort. We need to grow. We need to bring along, today I've understood it better, we need to bring along the whole of this other body to conform to the spirit and to the will of God. And when we get born again, we are not taken to heaven directly. So we need to live the salvation here and now. And Paul said that I no longer live, but Christ in me. So we die, Christ died for us, that we can live for him. When we receive Jesus Christ, then we need to die, put to death the flesh. The flesh, that, and someone says that this flesh is already at home, is already where it belongs. But we need now to cause it to conform to the will of God and to the word of God. I'm blessed. I don't want to preach more. So you bless whatever you touch to do, shall prosper. As you go out, you shall prosper. And as you lie down, you shall prosper. So I call you blessed of the Lord. Let's meet on Thursday for more. God bless you.